For fires, we have hydrants and firefighters. For flooding, we have levees and sandbags. For molds, we have cleanup professionals in silly science suits. As a general rule, our society does a pretty good job of dealing with environmental disasters. However, over the last half decade, a growing environmental threat has been the exception to this rule. Believe it or not, this is not a close-up of your grandmother's split pea soup. This is an aerial view of the harmful algal bloom, or HAB, that hit Utah Lake during the summer of 2016. It covered nearly 150 square miles and sickened over 100 people. It shut down lake recreation, and local farmers suffered major losses because the water couldn't be used for irrigation. The Utah Lake HAB is just one example among hundreds of HABs that have been growing in frequency and in impact, not just around Utah, but around the globe. HABs have hit Utah hard, but they aren't just a Utah problem. They are a global problem and a growing problem. Let's start by clearing up a few misconceptions about HABs. Harmful algal blooms aren't actually algae. They are cyanobacteria, which is a photosynthetic bacteria frequently mistaken for algae because of its blue-green color. While not all cyanobacteria are dangerous, various strains are responsible for producing toxins that can cause nausea or rashes, or poison your liver, or shut down your nervous system. Excess nutrients in places like Utah Lake can result from things like wastewater treatment plants or agricultural runoff. This can feed eutrophication, a process that recycles nutrients and amplifies blooms. The reason that it's really taken off over the last decade is because, as you can probably guess, climate change. Climate change causes warmer water temperatures and longer growing seasons. And when you combine these factors with generations worth of nutrient dumping, you're left with the perfect conditions for a global habpocalypse. With all this information, one can see why harmful algal blooms are the newest rising star in natural disaster infamy. However, the current solution when a harmful algal bloom occurs is to post a sign that says, "Hey, don't swim here." And that's about it. I work for a biological engineering research lab that deals with things like algae, cyanobacteria, and water resources. So when we saw this problem, we did what any decent engineers would do. We said to ourselves, there has to be a better solution. What we've come up with is a three-step environmental response. The first step, detection. For this, we partnered with Aggie Air and the epically named unmanned aerial vehicle, Dark Horse. Dark Horse, until recently, has been used to monitor the irrigation of vineyards in California. But today, we have trained Dark Horse to fly over a mapped water body and pinpoint blooms, differentiating between those that are harmful and those that are not. The next step, extraction. This part was tricky because, well, it requires filtering bacterial cells out of thousands of gallons of surface water in a targeted area. And don't forget, the water has the potential to be lethal. You can't just go to Costco and pick up an aquatic Roomba and start cleaning away. Instead, we had to build from the ground up. We were out on the beautiful recreational waters of the state, but underneath our safety vests were lab coats. We built a completely mobile harvester designed to take in lake water, filter it, and pump it back into the lake, keeping a slurry of toxic algae in an autoclave bag. Which brings us to step three, disposal. Cyanotoxins produced by HABs are very stubborn molecules that don't break down easily. One of the most promising ways of treating these is through anaerobic digestion. Fortunately, Central Valley Water Reclamation Facility is in a prime location for disposing of collected HABs, and it has the two largest digesters in the state. We ran experiments showing that Central Valley anaerobic sludge could break down the cyanotoxins. The great part about this is that these digesters are set up so that while they break down the bacteria, they also produce bio-methane and compost. We are literally turning bacteria and harmful environmental toxins into valuable fertilizer and fuel. Now, we don't have a fairy tale ending just yet. The reality of the HAB issue is that it's going to require a large-scale solution. Climate change, bad agricultural practices, and insufficient wastewater treatment methods are huge problems that are going to require generational changes in attitudes and behavior, as well as complex and controversial legislation. What we have built is a rudimentary tool to help solve a difficult problem, and it still needs some further research and fine-tuning before it can even be implemented on a large scale. That being said, a year ago, we started with nothing but a toxic pea soup problem, and today we have a plan and a means to achieve it. It might seem crazy to think that I, as one person, can have an impact on such a massive issue. To be honest, sometimes I think I'm a little crazy myself, but when I get that way, I think back on moments like the first night we got our harvester working. That night, I remember thinking, as I dripped cold, mucus-like pond scum through gloved fingers, this is what making a difference feels like.